premature babies for various conditions. So we are not worried from the anesthesia point of view.
Hmm.
The thing was tissue handling. The tissues are very delicate.
Hmm.
But the newer design implants are becoming flatter and flatter, so they no longer push the skin.
Hmm.
As the mastoid is concerned, even in a one-year-old child, we have an adequate size mastoid for us to do the surgery comfortably.
Hmm.
So we check all for the operation by doing imaging by way of a CT scan, MRI, etc. And if we are in for any surprises, we are pre-warned, so we can take precautions during surgery. But otherwise, anesthesia issues no longer exist. Surgical skill is now developed sufficiently. And diagnosis, thanks to the audiological workup being done so early, and a lot of places also doing newborn screening, I think we are seeing our patients earlier and earlier now, which is a great thing.
That's great to know, and thank you for your input, sir. Let me direct my next question to Vahishtai. Vahishtai, speaking about early intervention in children with hearing loss, you have vast experience in managing therapy of young babies. What is the age of youngest baby in your habilitation program?
9-month-old, Jasper.
Okay, yeah. That's great. So we are going below the age of 1 year in surgery and in habilitation, so it's good to hear that. Kanchan, about Dhwani, which is a unit of Save the Children India, specifically focuses on early intervention, right? What, according to you, is the importance of early intervention?
Early intervention, yes, absolutely. We've been speaking about it, and it's very important because it's very much related to the neurological emergency. So neurological emergency is like related to the language development, the spoken language, which, for which the critical period is like, you know, 3 years. And beyond 3 years, if the child has not got any amplification, it is really difficult to develop a spoken language. The child requires extra efforts to do so. So considering this critical period, and there are researchers supporting this fact that 90% of the auditory brain develops by this age. So it is really important that we get the hearing impaired children early, because once the audition, the foundation of is developed, which leads to the learning of spoken language and reading, writing, and ultimately age-appropriate integration in regular school.
Very valid inputs, Kanchan. Yes, the critical learning age is indeed something we need to focus on. Considering this critical period and understanding that hearing loss is a neurological emergency, I would like to ask Dr. Ketane, sir, how early can a baby get cochlear implant, assuming there are no cost concerns or surgical issues?
Yeah, it all depends upon how early you can make the diagnosis and tell us that, look, this is definitely an indication. As I said, the youngest I've done is 6 months. We were forced to do that. I would like to make it very clear over here that we can certainly operate under the age of 1 year. That's not an issue.
Yes, sir. But
it's after doing so many cases and having traveled around the country and seen other people operating and helping them, you have to realize that it's not everybody's cup of tea.
I
would suggest that the novice surgeon should stick to slightly older children, because these children require a certain amount of delicate surgical handling, which comes with a certain amount of experience. So it's not something that anybody and everybody should be doing. I think only people who've done a certain number of cases have the necessary skill now developed should be handling it. But doing them at 6 months plus, I think, is no issue. So I would say if I got a child who was completely diagnosed by the age of 6 months, I would be happy to do it.
Yes, sir, I can understand that if I have a 6 months old baby and I want to go for cochlear implant surgery, and I'll be very nervous about the surgeon, and I will check that he has practice, or he has good hands and he has been using cochlear implant on very, very young babies. Now, that's very much a concern. I understand that practice makes us perfect, and everybody, it's not everybody's cup of tea, I understand. Sir, I've seen you in OT operating, and it's like a magic what you do. I'm sure everybody cannot operate like that.
No, but, it's no magic. It's just a question of doing the same thing again and again. And I'm sure that anybody who gets that kind of exposure or experience will be able to do it as well.
I'm sure.
There's no magic involved.
It looks like magic to us. Thank you, sir. I agree with you. So Dr. Ketne is very clear that experience is very important. And according to him, we can have cochlear implant surgeries of babies below 1 year. 6 months, 8 months is all right. If the diagnosis is correct and anesthesia is not a problem, and now we have products which are designed for babies, so it's not an issue. But the surgeon should have experience. Am I right, sir?
Absolutely.
Thank you, sir. Ketki, we are glad you are here today representing the government. So what is the role of government schemes like ADIP for early intervention?
Under ADIP, since the scheme has been present, we have been providing hearing aids to start with. Like initially, there were only 40 level hearing aids. Last around 5 to 6 years, we have come up with BTs being provided under ADIP scheme. So under ADIP scheme, the first line of treatment or first step that is there after the diagnosis, that is wearing a hearing aid, that is provided free of cost. I have given the documents that are required or the procedure that is generally followed when we are issuing BT hearing aids for a beneficiary. So after the hearing aids, though these hearing aids are not say extra strong categories, like the most powerful ones that are available, but that this provides a good starting point. You know, the children can at least start with the training, and then later on, parents, if they want to see if they can optimize the hearing aid benefits, that can be a next step. So that's the starting point for ADIP schemes that we have. Of course, the next step is the ADIP CI program that has been there since 2014.
Thank you, Ketki. It's commendable to see the focus of our government to support early intervention for hearing loss and providing BTs. It's really appreciated. My next question is to Vahishtai. You have the experience of working in reputed centers, Vahishtai, like ORAID and EAR, and practicing privately. Some of your recipients are babies below the age of 2 years. And some are children who are 4 years and above. So the question to you is, what's your experience? Is there a correlation between the age of intervention and the levels of outcomes according to you?
Most certainly. There is a very, very direct correlation. In fact, let me start with my own son. He was diagnosed, he was detected when he was 1 month old, and has been mainstream right from the beginning because of early detection and early intervention. And in my experience working with children, the earlier the better. So as early as possible, also what Kanchan said about the critical period of development and the neural plasticity, that plays a huge role. So therefore, as early as possible, only thing is we need to make sure that the right hearing aids have been fitted, the right therapy has been started on time. And then if it's cochlear implant, if there is a profound or a severe to profound hearing loss, cochlear implant should be done as early as possible. Having said that, if the child is older and receives a cochlear implant, the neural connections in the brain are already wired differently. So therefore, that becomes a huge challenge for parents. It's not that it can't be done, but the journey is a huge uphill task. It takes much longer, and the child may never really reach the appropriate speech and language milestones that are needed as compared to children who are early intervened.
So will it affect their integration in regular schools?
Most certainly. Absolutely. So children who are implanted early, who are detected and intervened early, get into mainstream right away. with the right kind of guidance here. I'd really like to stress on the right kind of guidance, the right kind of therapeutic intervention that is given. Children can go into mainstreams without additional issues if there are, because we do have children who do have additional issues. But if there is a properly trained auditory verbal therapist with the right qualifications, she is equipped to work with the children and integrate them early enough, just with the typically hearing peers. Whereas if the children are older, they can't be mainstreamed right away. If they are by chance mainstreamed right away, then they do face huge problems of not being able to cope in the mainstream.
Thank you, Vaishtai. What's your experience as a parent? Your child got early identification, early intervention, and what was the result or benefit of that?
I think I would say I was really fortunate that we detected that he couldn't hear when he was a month old. And I feel that really we've been guided in the right direction from day one with all the experts in the field. So he's gone into regular school, play school at 2 years, regular nursery at 3 years, mainstream school at 4 years. So he's been intervened. I mean, he's in college now.
What's he doing now?
So he's just got into Symbiosis Pune.
Oh, wow.
For his MBA, yeah. So he's a physical fitness trainer, qualified physical fitness trainer. He's a sports enthusiast. He plays, he's been playing for the country. He's been playing badminton for the country. And now doing his management.
Thank you, Vaishtai. It's great. That real example of benefits of early intervention.
Thank you.
So what we learned is if a child is diagnosed and identified at the age of 1 month, like Jehan, then we can look forward to matching the milestones of typically developed children. That's what you said. Correct me if I'm wrong. And
absolutely.
Then they can go to the regular school at appropriate level. Yes?
Yes.
That's great. Kanchan, what is your take on this? What are the key differences in outcomes based on the age of intervention at your clinic?
Yes, absolutely. I agree with what Vaishtai just said. Just to add on to it, like, you know, the lesser the age, lesser is the language gap. And it is easier to bridge over it. The more the age at intervention, more the gap. And as Vaishtai mentioned, the more time and extra support it will take to develop the listening language and spoken language only using the auditory mode. Let me be very specific here that I'm talking about the auditory mode. And there are more chances of integration into regular school if we have early intervention. And that's what we've been experiencing at Dhwani. The children who have been coming to us early, we have been successfully integrating them in a regular school. And not that the late intervene can't, but they require more support, and age-appropriate integration is a challenge.
So Kanchan, at your Dhwani, what is the age you take for admission in Dhwani Early Intervention Center?
We take children below 3 years, but recently we have made that criteria to 2.6 years. So children below 2.6 years, we enroll. But not that whoever approaches us beyond that age, we reject them just on the basis of age. We guide them in whatever best possible ways. But yes, the criteria we kept is 2.6 years.
So from your experience, if you are taking children about 30 months old latest or below that, so what percentage of these children will be able to get into regular school? Any idea?
Yeah, as Vaishtai mentioned, that the indicators, like, you know, if there are no additional disabilities, the parents are hardworking and, like, you know, they are following whatever has been told. So almost like, you know, 80% of the kids, I would say, would get integrated into a regular school.
That's great. So what, Kanchan, you were saying, let me summarize and tell me if I'm wrong, is that there are many factors that affect the outcome, but early intervention or the age of implants and therapy is most important for speech and language development, right? Okay, thank you. Valid inputs by Vahishthai and Kanchan. Now let's get a surgeon's perspective. Dr. Keetane, what is your opinion about the role of habilitation in early intervention?
Okay, am I audible now?
Yes, sir.
Okay. As I've always mentioned, you know, right from day one, I have mentioned, and you must have heard me umpteen times, Jaspal, the role of the surgeon is 10%. The rest is up to you people. Because, you know, our job is put in the implant, takes an hour, hour and a half, close to wound. 7 days later, we are through with the patient. And you people, the habilitationists, have to do the back-breaking job of sitting there for 2 years or more, sometimes with a cranky child or a cranky parent, and wear it and get the job done. So I would really say, and I get a lot of requests from people saying, I want to start a cochlear implant program, and can you come and help me do the surgery? And my first question to them is, who is going to do the therapy? Without which you don't even think or dream of starting a program. And I get this peculiar question saying that you're doing it at Hinduja, but you don't have a habilitation program. How do you manage that? And we started right from the beginning with this hub and spoke system, where we would get patients from different centers. They trusted us, we trusted them, so that when I get a patient from a particular center, after surgery, when the patient goes back to that center, I have the confidence that the patient will get the best treatment. So I think it's the major job for the audiologist to do the mapping, and the habilitationist who really get the result out. We are only planting the seed. The grooming of the whole plant is done by these people. Without them, there is no cochlear implant program. Very clear.
Thank you, sir. Hub and spoke model started by you is very, very effective and popular. I remember more than 10 years back, first time I heard you in a hall saying that the same question was asked, and you said, I will put the seeds in the pot and the therapist is a gardener, how she will look after that. I've not forgotten that. And you still believe that. That's amazing.
Absolutely.
That's amazing. Thank you, sir. Very true. We as therapists have a crucial role of molding the child's future, and we have a great responsibility on our shoulders. Thank you, sir. Ketki, my next question is to you. How do you manage to connect with huge number of ADIP beneficiaries and ensure that they achieve good outcomes?
With the ADIP program, we have two separate teams looking at the whole functioning. So there is a separate post-operative rehabilitation team, which monitors the progress, and from both the points, like from the therapist's point of view also and from the parent's point of view also. And the work has always been on the telephone, because it's a pan-India program, so we wouldn't be able to visit each and every child personally, or even the therapy center personally. So it has always been over the phone. So the same thing continued once the pandemic started and we stopped physically coming to the office. We made few changes in terms of how the therapists are reporting the child's progress. So basically they have to tell us what is the mode of therapy that has been going on. Because parents also shifted to their native place. So from them, their side also, it was not possible for them to come to the therapy center. And of course, to maintain social distancing and everything, many places the actual therapy had stopped. Then the monitoring continued. The changes happened. Last month, we came up with SOPs, which were mailed to all the panels and paneled therapy centers for mapping and the therapy procedures that they can take.
Thank you very much, Ketki. It's nice to know that government is taking measurements to see that the children are on the track and they are tracking their progress. So nice to know about SOPs, which is being sent to different clinics so that they adhere to the rules and regulations. So from this, all we have learned today that a baby as young as 6 months or 8 months can receive cochlear implant, and it is not difficult to give cochlear implant or to do cochlear implant surgery on a baby who's less than 1 year old. But the baby, the surgeon should have experience of implant, using implant on babies. Also, Dr. Ketane said that now if early diagnosis is possible, anesthesia is not an issue, and we have designs of products which are designed for young babies, so that things are easier, and we have surgeons who have experience of taking babies for cochlear implant. We also learned that early intervention is very important for speech and language development of children. And our therapist told us that talked about auditory brain development and connections in the brain which are early connected. So speech listening in early year help children with hearing loss to be better learners and improve their speech. And this was also mentioned that if we get children very early, there are more chances of them being integrated into regular schools. And if they are older, it becomes more difficult, takes more efforts and more times. And we also have to be careful about additional issues in some of them. Ketki also told us that government is taking a lot of measures. We have rehab team now who's looking after the outcomes and seeing that the children with ADIP get good outcomes. So very nice to know all that. And yes, are we ready for the poll question? Hello, Habobi.
I think you can see it now. It's up.
I'm not able to see. I can only see H on my screen.
The poll question actually goes to the audience.
Yes.
I'm just waiting. Once I get about 150 responses, then I'll display it.
Yes.
Okay, I'm just over 145 now. So I'll wait 2 minutes and then I'll close the poll. I think you can see the results now.
Sorry, Havi, my screen doesn't show. So I would like you to announce that, please.
Yes. I can see them.
You can?
Yeah.
So I'll leave it to you to announce.
Oh, it's gone now.
Oh, okay.
I saw it and then it's gone. Sorry.
I have got it. Shall I read it out?
Thanks.
It says 98% agree, 2% disagree. That makes 100%. And then it says 1% maybe. So we've got 101%. 98% say yes, absolutely agree.
And what was the question?
Early intervention is crucial because it impacts outcomes of the recipients.
Okay.
And 98% agree to that statement, only 2% disagree.
Okay. Wonderful to see that everyone is convinced and agrees that hearing is so important, especially during the early years of life. And hence, early intervention plays a vital role in speech and language development. Since we have time, maybe we can come back to some of these early intervention questions. Yes, how are we?
Certainly.
So Currently, we are all faced with this pandemic situation. As unique and challenging these times are, we always need to focus on the positive side of things. Since we have our experts here, let us ask them how they are managing during these tough times. Since Ketki started talking about taking measures and how it is being affected by this, so that is why we shifted to this topic. But I would ask Dr. Ketane first. Sir, how has COVID-19 affected cochlear implant surgeries?
You're on mute, sir.
Okay, can you hear me now?
Yes, sir.
Okay. One thing that has happened is that the hospital suspended all the routine OPDs. Now, you know that every Tuesday we used to run a free OPD for cochlear implants where patients were being assessed and therefore we had a continuous flow of patients for surgery. Now, since that was stopped by the hospital because they didn't want, you know, the social distancing, etc., that flow stopped, but we still had a waiting list of quite a number of patients. Initially, we were told that we would not be allowed to do anything but emergency surgeries. Now, they've slowly opened up for routine surgery. So, next week, I've got 3 implants planned, but we still have to take precautions. So, one precaution is from the patient side. They are tested 1 week before and the night before for COVID positive or not. The child is allowed to come in the hospital with only one relative. So both parents cannot come. This is hospital regulation. And we take all precautions. Everybody is doffed up properly and, you know, gowns, face shield, everything. But we have to drill. And in drilling, a lot of bone dust gets thrown out, which is supposed to be bad for everybody around because the virus, if it's there in the air, will go. So what we've done is that besides draping the microscope, draping the patient, we sort of create a tent, a plastic tent around the patient. So the patient is inside the tent. We are all outside the tent. There are two slits made so that my hands can go inside through these slits. The microscope is inside the tent with the eyepieces outside the tent.
Okay.
So I can look through the microscope, but the rest of the microscope is all inside the tent. And I'm therefore able to operate, even if the bone dust is coming in, it's remaining all inside so that nobody else interferes. Now, this way, we take precautions that the patient doesn't infect us. But the biggest problem is, how do we know that the staff in the operation theater is all not going to be, you know, carrying the infection? So, therefore, this is something which we have to explain to the patient. Now, when we do the 3 cases next week, we will be telling them that, look, we will take all precautions. But if something does happen and the child does get an infection afterwards, I hope you won't hold us responsible. Because the best we can do is we can take precautions. Beyond that, it's not under our control. And a lot of patients whom we called for surgery turned around and said, no, we do not want to come to the hospital at this stage for the surgery. So we were willing to do the surgeries. But the parents have said, no, we don't want to come to the hospital. These 3 have agreed. All these 3 are patients where we have raised donations for them. And they have agreed to come. So it's picking up, it's starting. And as people come to know of more patients getting operated, I think more and more patients will start coming in. But precautions, absolutely strict precautions to be taken for everybody, completely covered and all isolation facilities. And I would minimize the stay in the hospital. If possible, I would like to discharge the patient the same evening so that even the hospital is cut off.
Yeah. Yeah, that's great. And it's amazing to know how you have decided to take precautions so clearly. And even surgeons are at risk. Everybody is, including the patient. So it's understandable that precautions are being taken and no risk can be taken with the surgery. Very understandable. Thank you. But the question still remains, sir, with early intervention being so important, what can be done for families who want to get their babies to receive cochlear implant at the earliest?
What
do you recommend?
No, this is the whole problem. You see, when they were with us, we hammered into their brain, do the operation as early as possible. And now that they're ready to do the operation, we are saying, sorry, the hospital is not allowing it. But there is something which we are not able to control, and that's the inflow of people from one district to another. I don't think there is so much of a problem of people coming into Mumbai.
Okay.
But if they come into Mumbai and then they go back to the place, they'll probably be quarantined for a certain length of time. They have to be prepared for that.
And they are not?
No, those who come, we will operate. Like these three who are coming, they're willing to come. But there are people who are finding it difficult to get transportation. If I have a patient from Akola, say, wants to come by train, he may not be allowed to come onto the train or may not get a ticket to come onto the train. And after he goes back, the local body may want to quarantine the patient. So these are things which are beyond our control. I mean, we can only do what we can within the hospital. But as you rightly said, how do we get them to the hospital? That's a different issue altogether, totally out of our control.
Yes, sir, I can understand there are situational problems which are not controllable. So we can control the controllables which cannot control everything.
One thing I may say here is that if any of these patients are wanting to come and not getting permission, we could certainly issue a letter saying that, look, this is an operation which is not an emergency, but it cannot be unduly delayed. So an early surgery is advisable. We can certainly issue a letter like that. Now, if on the strength of that letter, they are able to get permission to travel, then I think that is the best we can do for them.
But sir, nowadays that any doctor's letter is helping us to travel.
Yes.
So it's like a certificate that please allow me to travel. So that carries a lot of weight.
Yeah, but we cannot still call this as an emergency surgery. That would be wrong. See, if somebody requires an emergency surgery, then he would get permission to travel. I would not be in a position to say this is emergency. All I would be able to say is that undue delay should not be there, because it takes away the, you know, we've just insisted on early intervention. And then you make them, so if a child is diagnosed at, say, 14 months, and we make them wait 6 or 8 months because of the pandemic, then you're losing out on the plasticity, the brain plasticity issue. So we could at the most say, this needs to be done as early as possible, but can't label it as an emergency.
Correct, but who's the final authority to allow them to travel and come to the hospital?
It's the local district administration. For example, at Lonavala, for example, it's the local Lonavala Municipal Corporation who passes a law that no outsider will be allowed to come in. I was told that places like Mahabaleshwar, they put the barriers and say, sorry, you can't come in unless you are a resident of that place. No outsiders allowed. So some districts have done that.
Okay. Understandable. They have to control the situation also.
Administrative restrictions, yes.
Yeah. Thank you for your suggestions and your input, sir. A lot of information we got from you, Dr. Gitne. Now let us see how it is affecting therapy. So Kanchan, my question is to you. How is Dhwani adapting to the present situation to ensure progress of children with cochlear implant?
Yeah, currently, like, you know, since the lockdown started all of a sudden, and we had to, like, you know, shut down Dhwani Center, and we started working from home. And in that time, like, you know, we got ourselves updated through various webinars on tele-intervention, because that was the only way to connect with our beneficiaries in this difficult time. And we connected with the parents, we explained them this new way of, like, you know, therapy, because earlier we were not doing tele-intervention, and we had to convince them that this is the option now, and the further therapy sessions for further more months would be through telepractice. And we assured them that this will work. And so we got good support from our parents. I'm, like, you know, glad about that. And the parents were really grateful that even in this situation, they could continue to get guidance and therapy sessions from the Dhwani team at Save the Children India. And we were, like, you know, told to work from home, I think from 17th March. And we started our first trial tele-intervention session on 19th March. And because we had to adapt to it as soon as possible. And every session has been a learning, and there was no looking back. And we are striving to be better and better and to improvise our skills day by day. Even some families had gone to their hometown because of this. And we could connect with them also by means of teletherapy. And also there were new cases who were just enrolled before the lockdown. Like, you know, they had been diagnosed. Few of them got the hearing aids. Few of them were without hearing aids. But we connected with those families also. And they had no clue about how therapy is. So we could connect with them and, like, you know, bring the child to a certain level. And I'm really glad that we could reach out to them. And we, like, you know, we could conduct our half yearly assessment and discuss our reports with the parents. So, like, you know, all this was possible because of teletherapy.
But like, you were not doing it earlier, so you had no experience. And how did you manage to start with it? What helped you?
We updated through webinars. There were a lot of webinars on teleintervention and a lot of reading material which we had to go through. And that's what helped. And initially it was trial and error, but now I can say we can, like, you know, confidently take a teletherapy session.
So how did you manage switch-ons? Some switch-ons also might be affected because suddenly there was a lockdown.
Yes, so one of our beneficiaries, like, you know, she had got operated just when the lockdown began, and the switch-on was postponed due to that. But the audiologist team, like, you know, we had to, like, you know, coordinate with a lot of people. And ultimately, like, you know, we could do the switch on, bilateral switch on of that child. So a lot of back and forth for that. But yes, we could do that.
Okay, that's nice. So good to see that you're adapting so well to the circumstances and changing the mode of therapy to keep them on the line, tracking their progress. What are you doing to constantly stay abreast of latest best practices, Kanchan, to help you continue with your practice seamlessly? Since you're so busy with your clinic, all of you, you are so much overloaded and you have no time in between, but you do need to upgrade your skills. So how do you do that?
Yeah, this has been a good time to do that. And there are a lot of webinars arranged through Cochlear, through there's a Hearing First website. So there is a lot of material available on that. Also, the Speech Language Pathologists That Association has been coming up with a lot of information, and who have been professionals who have been already in this field. So they are helping out other professionals who are not in teletherapy. So that scare of taking a teletherapy session is gone. And so there is no option but this. So it's been a great experience learning that.
Absolutely, Kanchan. Upskilling.
And my message to all my colleague therapists is that, like, you know, it is very much doable. It is not that it is very difficult or something. Yes, you need to be into practice before, if you have an experience of face-to-face therapy, it could be easier for you to transform it into a teletherapy session.
That's great. So Kanchan is giving a message that teletherapy is not a rocket science. It can be learned. It's easy. Provided you want to learn, you should have the motivation. And like they say, need is always the necessity of invention. So because there was a need, we learned it and we started doing it. And then we found, oh, wow, we can do it. It's not that difficult. That's nice, Kanchan. Ketki, my next question is to you. I recall from the previous webinar that Ali Yevajang National Institute for Speech and Hearing Disabilities working on making universal newborn hearing screening mandatory in Maharashtra, correct?
Yes.
It shows how committed you are towards the early identification and early intervention for those with hearing loss. And thank you for that. The question is, how is this intervention affected by the present COVID-19 situation?
In the sense, how this universal hearing screening coming up, I am actually...
Is there a stop?
There is not a stop, but definitely the focus is not, the government's focus is not on this at present. Because they have a bigger issue to handle right now. from our side, everything is ready, but I think from government side to focus on this issue at this point is a bit difficult, from the government officials. It's a bit difficult to get attention to this issue at this point.
So what is the focus of the what is the focus at this point by the government, which is preferred focus, priority basis?
What we have been told is the services that we are giving to the disabled population should be uninterrupted. So right now, our services are continuing in terms of issuing certificates, issuing the railway concessions, issuing the hearing aids, troubleshooting, hearing aid repair. All those things are going on, but new diagnostic procedures are not happening that much at present. Like, we have not started with BERA yet, but PTAs. We have started with, we do hearing aid trials, benefit trials we do. And from EDIP CI point of view, the administrative procedure is going on. Like, we are getting applications, those are getting scrutinized, approvals are being sent. That thing is happening.
Jaspal, can I just say something here?
Yes, sir, please. My pleasure.
You know, the difficulty with the universal newborn screening is because in our country, even in major cities, a lot of home deliveries get conducted, and there are tiny nursing homes, individual gynecologists, very small nursing homes. It's not as if there are some only major hospitals where deliveries are done, where you could institute. So it's not easy to get all of these people to cooperate. And one suggestion which I could have for Ketki is that, you know, at least everybody now, wherever they are born, get a birth certificate which has to be registered. So if we can work from that channel, that when somebody comes for registration of a birth certificate, you say, well, it is linked to the fact that you get a hearing test done, get us the result, and then we issue the birth certificate. Because you're going to have deliveries occurring in the smallest of places, tier 3 cities, villages, dais doing it. And it's going to be impossible to get all those people into coming in for newborn screening. So there has to be some point where everybody has to go. And I think the birth certificate is one point where everybody has to get it registered. And that's where, if we can get the government to say, make it mandatory that you have a hearing test report with you before registering, that's the only way we might be able to push it further. This is what I feel.
I'll definitely forward this suggestion to our director, ma'am.
Because that is one point where everybody has to come and register the certificate.
We were looking at the immunization part of it.
Yeah, but that is still individual. A lot of village people may not go for immunization. Yeah. But everybody wants to get the certificate registered because it is required for everything else afterwards.
Yes, Ketki, do you agree with that?
Yes, yes. Definitely.
So, thank you. I hope you will take it at to the authorities. And thank you, Dr. Ketane. We are obliged to you for your intervention, and you really, really gave a very good suggestion, which is practical, possible, and cannot fail at all, because they have to go for birth certificate. That's great. Thank you so much. Ketki, it is understandable that you have challenges, a lot of challenges seeing the during this situation, tough times, seeing the large, huge caseload. But it's good to know that the team is trying their best to support all beneficiaries. I go back to Vahishtai. Vahishtai, coming back to telepractice, which is the norm in this time, in tough time, everybody is doing that. That's the only way we can do this rehabilitation or habilitation. You have been practicing teletherapy even before the pandemic hit us, right?
Yes.
In your opinion, is telepractice as good as face-to-face therapy?
So there are two parts to the whole thing. I think we need to, as professionals, understand the advantages and disadvantages. Telepractice is a great mode of therapy, provided you have learned how to do it, you know how to do it. It is very important to have the skills. So what I find is that with telepractice, you can guide and coach parents a lot more because you're not there physically to do it. But you need to have those skills of guiding and coaching as a professional to be able to do it on scene. It is not so easy to just start doing it. So if you are an experienced professional, yes, it makes a lot of sense to do it. It's easy because you can reach to a much larger population without the expense and all of that. However, for newer professionals who've had to jump into this with their eyes closed, I would really say that once we restart and face-to-face is possible, I think the advantages of face-to-face are very great. So we need to make sure that we know as professionals our own skills and expertise to be able to do tele-intervention where that is possible and where face-to-face is possible. So I would say as an experienced professional, yes, teletherapy is possible. And as a newer therapist, I think we need to make sure that we continue to do face-to-face when we open up.
So what you're saying is, check me again, that once the situation comes back to normal, you would prefer face-to-face therapy if it is possible,
right,
than to teletherapy.
Yes. Face-to-face always has advantages. Like I said, there are advantages on both. So yes, when things open up, face-to-face is better. But in situations where teletherapy, people are not able to travel and they're, you know, getting in touch with you from remote areas, yes, by all means, it is important for us to reach out to the families and professionals. So I would really say that your skills are come into play here. How you coach and guide families, how you hand over to families, what are the things that you use? You need to use things from their own homes and all of that. So there are a lot of pre-planning, lot of joint discussions with families and then post discussions. So there is a lot that goes on. It is not as quick and simple as it seems, but it is effective if you are experienced.
Very true. Considering the current situation, this is the best what we can offer as therapists.
Absolutely.
To ensure that at least the rehabilitation doesn't stop. I agree with you. But when you are doing teletherapy, how do you track the progress? Because generally, face-to-face therapy, you do a lot of tests, assessments.
Yes.
So how do you do assessments when you are doing teletherapy?
Assessments are done online. There also, there is a lot of observation. There is a lot of speaking to the parents. There are a lot of assessments which can be done online. Now there are a lot of electronic assessments available also. Yeah.
Okay. Question answers type scale.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you so much. Kanchan, you too mentioned that you are conducting teletherapy also. So my question to you is, what challenges do you face in services to underprivileged children with hearing loss, especially in present situation?
Yeah, like many of the families we intervene are from marginalized communities. So unavailability of an ideal setup, like, you know, a laptop is required or a PC and a good bandwidth internet connection is required. So this was a challenge. But most of them had smartphones, so we could connect over smartphones. And another challenge was, like, you know, engaging the child over a virtual session was challenging. But with practice and some creative ideas, we could achieve a good stability with them. And also another thing, like, you know, we since the session was in home environment, so we had to ensure that the there was a quiet environment so that the session could go smoothly. And as Vaishnavi has mentioned already, that the teletherapy takes more time in preparation. Like we have to send the plan to the parents and discuss with them so that they understand, because ultimately they are the ones who are going to execute the therapy.
Correct.
And we from here are going to guide them, how to talk, which strategy to use. So it is a lot of parent-directed thing. And once they understand, and as Vaishnavi mentioned, we had to use all the material available at home, which was we had to see if I'm planning this particular activity, whether the parent would have those things. So the regularly available things were required to be used. But that facilitated a lot of good learning, because that was so natural and using the household items. And with a few of them, they didn't even have a smartphone. So with such cases, we continued to give our support over the telephonic conversations. So something better than nothing. And asking the parents to share a video recording of the child and the activity. And then we used to go through that and then guide them accordingly how they could do it better. It's been challenging, but yes, we have come out with the solutions for that, and we have been able to provide our support.
So the same question to you, Kanchan. Yes, please continue.
Yeah. One more thing I wanted to add, that the regularity was quite observed to be good here, because traveling was not there. So sessions were less cancelled or unless and until some major issue. But otherwise, and we scheduled the sessions as the child's and the parents' convenience. So that helped for more attendance. And the follow-up in the natural environment was the biggest boon in this.
Yeah. So it looks like teletherapy is very successful in all these clinics. The same question to you again. How do you do the assessments and track the progress of the outcomes when you are doing teletherapy?
Okay, this was using the scales which we use, the integrated scales and the auditory learning guide. So it was a lot of through observation whether the child is doing a particular task, or it was through asking the parents whether the child is achieved a particular goal.
Okay.
So it was both ways, through observation and through asking the parents.
Okay. Sir, Dr. Kirtane, can I come back to you with a question? So we just saw that these therapists are directly assessing and seeing that the rate of progress is kept and the children are getting good outcomes, whether they are face-to-face therapy or they are in teletherapy. So you have a hub and spoke model. And how do you check and supervise that the children are getting good outcomes?
Well, we are a bit dependent on the feedback that we get from the centers. As a matter of fact, last year when we had the update, we circulated a particular format in which we would like the centers to give us the report. We are doing that again next week, or this weekend we are having another workshop where the same will be circulated. And it's not for us, it's not possible for us to directly contact the patients.
Correct.
So we are in touch with the various therapy centers to which our patients go. So if they have any problem, they would immediately report to us. And all these patients get priority in the sense, even in the busy OPD, no appointment, nothing. Any patient with a cochlear implant coming in with any problem, or any clinician coming in, get prompt attention. But I think it would be nice if we could establish a system whereby all these centers would send us regular reports. Because our worry is not about the kind of quality of care that they get. Our worry is about some of the patients may drop out because of certain issues, which if addressed in time, would prevent them from dropping out. That is what our interest is. Especially these are people who have got, for example, the ADIP scheme, or what we supply from our donations.
Yes, sir.
People who are economically weak. Now, in a situation like what is happening now, with no income coming in, even doing things like changing the batteries or paying your bills for the telephone, etc., is going to be a problem. So these are issues which, if brought to notice, can be tackled at a certain level. And what you say is very right. We would write even a more active interaction with these hub and spoke. But we keep on meeting once a year with all the audiologists, with all the educators. So there is a lot of exchange going on. And all of them, if they have any problem with the child, will immediately contact us and we give them prompt attention. Our fear is that there are people who are going to drop out. I'm sure even Ketki will agree that some people may drop out. And they don't drop out because they're callous. They sometimes drop out because they're helpless, because of financial issues. And I think this is where we could play a role and help them out a little bit. So having this feedback of people having difficulties is something that we would really want from the spokes.
Thank you, sir. You are not expected to contact directly each and every recipient, of course. But supervising is enough. Even if the therapists know that you will ask about the outcomes and assessments, they will work because you do care for that. So that is enough. And
I would not use the word supervise. We trust them implicitly, so we don't have to supervise them.
Okay, sorry. If that is the wrong word.
We trust them completely. And if I didn't trust a particular center, I wouldn't ask my patient to go there. So if my patients are going to a center, then it's because I trust them fully. But I would really appreciate if they were more regular in sharing their information with us.
So what I meant was that you are concerned about their outcomes and you will ask for their outcomes and you are interested in. Because sometimes it is the surgeon, as a surgeon, you have done the surgery and your work is over. So that can be the attitude very easily. But if I know that as a surgeon, you don't want to know about it, I may be a little negligent, but if I know you're going to ask me, I'll be more careful, and that's a motivation. So
this is where we are circulating this particular format in which we want reports to come in at least for the first 3 years, maybe 6 months, 1 year, 2 years, 3 years.
That's very good. Very good. Thank you so much for your inputs and suggestions.
But no supervision.
Yes, sir. No supervision. Actually, yes, we cannot do supervision. There's no supervision. I didn't mean actually supervision.
Keeping track.
I meant to track the progress. That's what I meant. And Ketki, what steps are being taken to ensure that ADIP children do not get off air in the current situation?
Jaspal, I'm sorry to just butt in over here, but we have, you know, some of our participants waiting for their questions to be answered and we are running a bit short. So we'll have to run this a bit quickly. So that
this is the last question, Farida.
Yes. So because they are really, really waiting to, you know, throw some questions that are, you know, expert speakers. Yeah. I'm sorry about that.
Yes, of course. This is the last question. Yes, Kate.
So under EDIF, the procedure is that if you have any requirement for accessories or repairs and all, the request comes in through the therapist to our coordinators and they forward it and arrange for the donations or anything if it's required, or for the discounts any if it is required by the parent. So the same procedure has been continuing, and we are trying to help to speed up that process.
Okay, thank you very much for your inputs. I wanted to ask Dr. Keetane, because a lot of professionals and parents are attending this webinar. So, sir, is there anything last, you would like to share any final message for them?
You know, we talked a lot about the role of the surgeon, the audiologist, and the therapist. What we didn't call on or talk about was the role of the parents. I think they are an integral part of the team and they have to be involved in the therapy of the child and the management of the child. So the more proactive they are, the better is the outcome. This is what we have observed all throughout. So it's not just the audiologist and the therapist, but the parents who are also an absolute necessity to the success of the program. So they have to be proactive.
Correct. We have to guide them and coach them as therapists and not take direct therapy. We agree with you, sir. Thank you very much, all of you. My sincere thanks to all attendees. My special thanks to panelists for their valuable time and insights. And over to you, Farida.
Thank you, Jaspal.
Thank you.
Fantastic job, Jaspal. Fantastic.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, ma'am.
So Parena has a question. I have a 15-year-old student with severe hearing impairment, with hearing loss, who refuses to wear a hearing aid or refuses to get any evaluation done. Speech is not clear. Reading and writing vocabulary is very limited. Lip reads most of the time. No knowledge of sign language too. I can't understand. How do I teach him? So can I direct this question to Vahishtai?
Sure. So I would say that firstly, you know, we work with children to teach them through audition, to
yes.
learn to listen and speak. So I would really say that a 15-year-old, if he's got hearing severe hearing loss and refuses to wear a hearing aid or get an evaluation done, it's going to be really, really hard for you to do this. I think you need to speak to the family and understand what's going on. Maybe one of the things that you can do is guide them to a counselor. Maybe the family needs counseling. Maybe the child needs counseling. Many a times what happens is that in the teen years, when families decide that now my child needs a to wear a hearing aid, it becomes very difficult for those children because they have learned to use a different mode of communication. And for them to suddenly start using a hearing aid and start communicating is hard. So I would really say get a proper counseling done for this family and maybe talk to the child to really understand, does he really want to wear the hearing aid? Also, one of the things I think we need to also understand is that without listening and spoken language, literacy gets really badly affected. So it is a fallback, unfortunately, of that. I don't know if the child is going to a deaf school or, has been to any of these deaf schools, but I've worked with some children who have been to these schools before, but they do not achieve good speech and language if they don't use hearing devices at an early age. So just like what we spoke about, early intervention is the key.
Thank you, Vahishtai. Okay. Is cochlear implant surgery safe? Is the question to Dr. Ketanai.
Sir, you're on mute.
It is absolutely safe in properly trained hands. You know, in many medical colleges where ear surgery is also taught, cochlear implant surgery may not be done in every medical college. So everybody who just graduates out of a medical college with an ENT degree is not competent to do a cochlear implant. He would have to take a little extra training and then start off by attending workshops, taking training, having a mentor, which is extremely important when you do your first cases, that you have somebody standing by to make sure that it's properly done. And once the mentor decides that the surgeon is good enough, then he can do it on his own. So I think your question is very, very valid. It is safe surgery. Properly, it is done by properly, adequately trained surgeons. There is nothing wrong with it.
Thank you, sir. I hope you got the answer, Birumrar. Next question is, does the government ADIP scheme also support the post-operative rehabilitation? Ketki, the question is to you.
Yes, the government supports post-operative rehabilitation for both mapping and therapy. For mapping, it supports for 3 years And for therapy, it is for 2 years when it is thrice a week. So if by any chance if a parent are not able to take therapy thrice a week, the same numbers can be extended beyond 2 years also. So it does support post-operative rehabilitation.
Thank you. Next question is, I'm a parent of a child with hearing loss who's diagnosed at age of 9 months. Now he's 16 years old and in 10th standard completed with 80% marks. Dr. Milan Kirtane sir has guided at that time when he was 2.5 years old. So what is the question, Rakhi?
There's no question, but I just thought it was a nice story to share with the audience.
Oh, it's a comment. So thank you, Dr. Kirtane, that you had guided when he was only 2.5 years old. He got early intervention, so he's doing well. Thank you. Nice to know that. So the question next, what are the criteria for cochlear implants? Sir, can you answer this question, please?
I think the criteria for the cochlear implant are very clear in the sense, basically you have somebody with severe to profound deafness where the hearing aid is not giving adequate benefit, so that with the hearing aid, the patient is not going to be able to develop good language and speech. And this is where the decision is not so much by the surgeon. It is the audiologist and the people who train the child with the hearing aid who will make up this decision that, look, we've tried a hearing aid and we are not able to bring the child to a level that we would like. And that is when the patient is referred to the surgeon. From the surgeon's point of view, we will reconfirm these tests and do the imaging, because what is extremely important is not your audiological profile, but when we do the CT scan and the MRI to see that everything is in order for the cochlear implant to work. You may have patients who don't do well with hearing aids because they don't have a cochlear nerve. So then doing an operation in such a patient would be of no use. Or they have central nervous system problems, leukodystrophy, where a cochlear implant may not give benefit. So that is my part. After the audiological decision is made, the radiological and the clinical decision whether to do an implant or not is what the surgeon does. But the criteria, these are decided by the people who fit the hearing aid and train the child with that hearing aid.
Thank you, sir. The next question, this is already, yes. Good evening to all. My question is to Jaspal ma'am, okay? What all changes one should keep in mind before planning therapy if the child is hearing impaired with ASD or ADHD? See, the children with difficulties, with additional difficulties are called red flag cases. So this child is a red flag case, but before going into the planning, you must do investigation and proper evaluation. Sometimes we just label the children saying he's ADHD because he's not paying attention in the session. So objective assessment should be done. And once it is found that the child has additional problem, then the therapy plan will be made according to that, that the goals are individualized according to the need and the age and stage of the child. And you will have less goals. And this child has to be handled by other professionals for his other disability or difficulty. Hope that answers your question, Disha. Okay, next question.
Before you take the next question, just wanted to add something to what I said regarding the criteria.
Yes, sir.
Today, all this time we were always operating on children or patients, even adults, with bilateral deafness. But now the whole world is turning towards the importance of binaural hearing. And therefore, we are getting more and more patients where 1 year may be serviceable, the other year is deaf. And in order to give benefit of binaural hearing, we are now operating even on patients with unilateral deafness. And it has been shown very clearly that in a bilaterally deaf child, if you do a cochlear implant on one side, the child does well. And I'm sure, as Vaishnavi will bear me out, if you do it on the other side as well and you give binaural hearing, then there is a distinct improvement in the performance of the child. So it's not necessarily only bilateral deafness. even a one-sided deafness can benefit by a cochlear implant in the deaf ear. So that I would like to add to the criteria for deciding on cochlear implants.
So that's nice to know. Single-sided deafness is also a criteria for cochlear implant. That's what you're saying, sir. Thank you very much. Okay. So next question, what is the role of ENT in pre- and post-implant rehabilitation? As far as monitoring outcomes is concerned in both red flag cases as well as typically profound hearing aid children.
Okay, the role of the ENT, of course, is the preoperative clinical evaluation to see that there is no other middle ear or external ear disease. There is no otitis media, that the cochlea is well formed, the cochlear nerve is present, so that we pass the patient on to the audiologist knowing that the external auditory canal is clear, a hearing aid can be fitted. Post-implant rehabilitation, we are not so much concerned with, but if they have any problems with the wound, sometimes with the magnet being too tight or the wound causing pain, or sometimes some patients getting non-auditory sensations with the implant, that is where we come in to check whether the implant has been properly placed. You might do an X-ray or a CT scan to find out whether there is anything wrong, the implant has gone in the wrong place. So this is where we would come in to monitor the post-operative rehabilitation. And if there are red flag cases where we as surgery felt that we are likely to run into problems, then we would coordinate, we would pass on our concerns to the audiologist for the mapping and to the therapist, and then exchange notes to make sure that everything is in order.
Thank you, sir. Shruti wants to know, can switch on and mapping be done virtually and wirelessly? Kanchan, can you answer this question?
I think yes, the technology has advanced now, and with the WPP software, we can do the switch on and mapping virtually and wirelessly.
Vaishtai, do you want to add something in that?
No, what I'd like to add is that I've been working with my audiologist, who has been regularly doing telemapping and teletherapy effortlessly. So I think this is certainly possible. It's just what is important is that we need to make sure that the hardware is there on the other side. So
in BPP, in WPP, wireless programming pod?
Yeah. So that the hardware needs to be there on the other side. Only then it is possible.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Ketki, this is a question for you. What are the steps to get a cochlear implant? I think they mean through EDIP scheme here.
Yeah. You can put an application either online or offline. Online application, the website is www.edipcochlearimplant.in. Or you can just put the fill in the form there or take a printout of that form and submit it to our office. There are a few documents that need to be attached along with it, which will be mentioned along with the form. If we have time here, I can list it. Shall I go ahead?
Yes, please.
Yeah. One first thing that we need is the birth certificate of the child, then the income certificate of parents, because these are the two things which based on which we will be deciding the criteria, eligibility criteria for cochlear implants under EDIP scheme. Other than that, if there is a caste certificate, Aadhaar card, and then come the clinical reports. In clinical reports, we require audiological evaluation reports, speech and language evaluation reports, psychological evaluation report, and a benefit trial after at least 3 months of usage of an appropriate hearing aid, and a CT scan report and an MRI report. So based on that, these are the basic reports. These are scrutinized by the screening committee, and if there are more opinions required by more professionals, that will be communicated to you, and then you can submit the relevant papers then later on.
Thank you, Ketki. That was quite clear and very clear. Thank you so much. Question for Vahishtai. How do therapists cope up with network issue? any substitute available so that we can use that for a child in rural area interested in tele therapy?
So, unfortunately, there is no substitute to network issues. I mean, I would really say, but what you can do is, one of the ways to do it is that you discuss on the phone with the family what plan, the goals, all of that. Maybe you can discuss it via WhatsApp or whatever. You plan it together. And if there is truly a network issue, then one of the ways to do it is that you ask the parent to go through the plan. Maybe she can record the child doing that, send it back to you, evaluate it, discuss it with the family, plan further. I mean, this I would say is only and only if there is absolutely no possibility of seeing the child. Because as a therapist, I think it's important for you to be there to guide and coach the parent as the parent is doing working with their child. But if you guided and coached the parent enough in the pre-preparation, then I think it is a possibility.
Thank you, Vahishtai. Hope that answers the question. Is there any more question?
There are, but we are now at 6 o'clock. So I'm going to take the liberty of bringing on the feedback poll and handing over to Farida.
Thank you, Khabobi.
I'll request you to for the audience.
Yes. The meantime, the poll is coming. I would say that this has been, you know, such an interesting and topics that we have been discussing here. And I wish if there was no constraint of time, we could go on and on and on. And some lovely, you know, inputs that, you know, were brought in by Dr. Kirtane, especially about the you know, neonatal screening, the early screening, and about, you know, the having some sort of a, you know, a checklist, you know, when you're getting the birth certificate, saying that if you have a hearing aid, you know, test done, so please put up your reports over there before getting there. This was wonderful, you know, yes, input given by, I think, Dr. Kirtane. That is really very nice. We have been insisting, you know, here on early diagnosis and how important it is to get the diagnosis done. And then we went on to say, you know, how, you know, early diagnosis help us to, you know, put them back into the mainstream early, helps us in integrating them at an early stage. There were enough, you know, examples given by Vaishtai and also by Kanchan, you know. So this is really so important. Once the diagnosis is done early, it's up to the parents, it's up to the professionals working with them. So to actually guide the family, counseling the family, that's what was brought up by Vaishtai in one of, you know, the things that she was saying. It's so important that we counsel them, we guide them, we show them the right path. We have also seen that in times like this, you know, Ketki has, you know, told us how teletherapy, Vaishtai, even Kanchan was telling, you know, it's no rocket science to do teletherapy right now when we are doing all these things, you know. And it's also important that we have the skills. And what's more important, and I felt what was, it was very interesting when Kanchan was speaking, is the need-based, you know, therapies that we are doing with whatever is, you know, available in the environment, the surrounding the child is living. And I think this is going to be such a good learning experience for the child also, because we are picking up things from the environment the child is coming. And we have also seen the polls. We have seen the polls where we saw that there were about, you know, 33% and about 39% of special educators and, you know, the practitioners from the field, professionals. So one word I, you know, that comes to my mind today is, you know, if we look at the word reach, And each one of us, you know, the each word, you know, in that word reach out to, you know, professionals, people in this field, and see how best we can, you know, get it working for our own, you know, beneficiaries, how well we can, you know, support our communities. I think that would be really, really great. If we could be able to do that. And just the way that we are staying connected right now, collaborating and working, if we work through, you know, the experts like y'all, if I need something, I can reach out to you and, you know, get my questions answered. And of course, ultimately, you know, so beautifully, Dr. Kirtane put it, ultimately, it's the parents, you know, who are, you know, at the crust of it all, you know, if we can really support and empower and help these parents to somehow make this, you know, happen for their child, I think nothing like it. So, yes, we are all in it together, and we are all, you know, going to get through this you know, pandemic that we all are. Hopefully, let's keep that hope very, very alive. And we are all there to help each other and work. I think that's the message we all should take, you know, from this webinar today. I have the poll results here with me. And all those who have attended, they have, you know, about 99% say that the information that they have learned, you know, from this webinar, you know, is going to be very, very useful for them, and they're going to use it. The discussions were really insightful, and the overall 92% are, you know, participants are really satisfied with the workshop. So I request all the participants also that this is not the end of it. Please stay in touch, you know, and connect, and reach is the word for today, I guess. So reach out and make this happen. I thank you, Dr. Kirtane, for spending such valuable time with us. Really, I mean, your words are something that are not going to be, you know, wiped out from our memories for a long time. And this is not the first time we have heard you. I think we have heard you, and every time you have made such an impression. So thank you very much for being with us. Vaishtai, thank you so much. It's always so inspiring to know, you know, with your own life experience and the way, and we are so happy for the success of your son. And I hope there will be lots, many mothers who will come up and tell us the success stories. You know, if we have people like speakers and people like you working in this field. Thank you, Ketki, for being with us and both these webinars. So much to add, you know, and really, I mean, we of course, you know, government is doing so much more, and we need to really add on to it, and inputs from, you know, people, experts like this. I think this is something that we need to take it up and make, you know, the screening mandatory, you know, as early as possible. So that's newborn, something is something. And I think Dhwani is doing a really great job in, you know, screening. You know, they have been screening at a very, very early age, and they are reaching out in the communities. And hopefully, you know, once the COVID is passed, and we can again go back and do the newborn hearing and screening, you know, I mean, that's the way I'm sure my colleagues have planned. Kate, Kanchan, thank you so much, you know, for giving us input of what the therapies that you have been doing. And I've been looking at some chats here with the parents of Dhwani, saying how helpful it has been. So really great job. Jaspal, don't hide there. You have been holding this session so beautifully and asking such lovely questions. I wish we had some more time on us, and we could go on and on and on hearing from the experts. But we are going to catch you all soon. We are not going to let you go just like that. And I'm sure all the participants, all the attendees who are here are also going to, you know, connect with you, and we'll get some more, you know, inputs from you, some really, really expert, you know, inputs from you. So thank you so much. Thank you. Thanks to all the attendees over here today. So this, we are concluding our two-part series of intervention and identification. And if you have, you know, any queries, any questions, please do write to us. We have already, you know, given us, you know, our connect, you know, our email IDs. So please connect to the organization. And if there are any questions that needs to be, you know, sent to, out to the expert panels. We will do it on your behalf. We will send it across to them, and our expert panel will be happy to answer them for you. So thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Farida, Havovi, Akanksha, Kanchan.